And so this is Jack Chai and Susan Liu and Cadence. Oh, she's all decked out. Love it. Come on up here. As Jack and Susan explained to me, you know, what's in a name, right? Just a little bit about the name that they chose for Cadence. Cadence was it Jack? Were you the one that was explaining that it was when you were in high school? Was I reading that? Oh, it was Susan. I'm sorry. When Susan was in high school, they discussed what their favorite cadence was. So if someone asks her what her favorite cadence is now, all she has to do is point to her baby. I love that. There is something else called imperfect cadence, which is a reminder of how even though we are imperfect, God still loves us. Not to mention, it is a very unique name. I agree. Grace, her middle name, is a reminder of how God chose us and saves us. Cadence herself is a gift of God's grace. Plus, they chose to, I love this, they chose to put a biblical name in the middle of her name as a reminder that they desire for God to have the center of her life. And Chai is Jack's family name. The life verse they chose for Cadence is Colossians 1, 9 through 12. It says this, "We are asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding, so that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work and growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the saints' inheritance in the light." Dear friends, the family is a divine institution, God ordained from the beginning of human history, and children are a heritage from the Lord committed by him to their parents for care, protection, for training, for his glory. And it is important that all parents recognize their sacred obligation and their responsibility to God in this matter, and we honor these parents for their desire to do so today. Recognizing the sacredness of their responsibility, these parents bring back to the Lord the treasure which he has entrusted to them. And in so doing, they publicly acknowledge their responsibility for their nurture and admonition of this child in the ways of holiness and godliness. These parents come with the same awareness that children belong to God and are entrusted to them for the purpose of raising and training for his will. And this is important. This ceremony does not guarantee the eternal life of their child. Rather, these parents are coming to the Lord and to the congregation for three reasons. First, to present this child to the Lord for his blessing. Second, to dedicate themselves even more to the task that they have before them. And third, to ask for the help and prayers of the church. This is a group project. Hope you're ready for this here in a moment. So, Jack and Susan, do you affirm that you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior? Do you acknowledge that this dedication does not save your child? Do you solemnly promise before God and these witnesses that with God's help and guidance, you will undertake to bring your child to trust Jesus Christ as Savior and serve him as Lord, making use of all the helps God has given you in the family and the church? Do you promise with God's help to raise your child in the training of God's word and the community of the church, to pray with and for her and to live before her as Christian parents who are yourselves subject to the Lord? Okay, now I didn't give advance warning on this, but are there members of your ethos community that are here this afternoon? A couple, okay. So, maybe in the back as well, okay. So, ethos community, do you acknowledge before Christ and his church that you desire to live as an example of righteousness and faith to this child? If so, answer, we do. And to the congregation, do you solemnly promise before God and one another that with God's help and guidance, you will support these parents with your prayers and seek to fulfill their responsibilities to their child? And do you promise to assist them by providing encouragement, counsel, ministries to guide them in the ways of godliness? If so, answer, we do. We do. Awesome. Well, now in the Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we dedicate to you Cadence Grace Chai. We dedicate Cadence to your protection and grace in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We ask, Lord, that you would give wisdom and grace to these dear parents as they face the unique challenges of parenting. Provide for all their needs as they serve you in this important ministry. And we pray for Cadence. As she grows up, we pray that she will know and love you and develop into a wise and godly woman in whom you are glorified. For Christ's sake, we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, church, I now have the privilege of presenting to you Cadence Grace Chai. Let's praise God together for his incredible gift. We have this kids' Bible we'd love to get into your hands. I hope that is a part of your family discipleship and your journey together. And speaking of which, we'd like to invite the kids forward for our kids' moment. And Miss Kat is going to come up and help lead that, so you may return to your seats. Thank you so much. As you as you're able today, please greet Jack and Susan and Cadence. And it's a privilege to be able to walk alongside them in their journey through family discipleship.
I can see the kids are making their way up. You guys can have a seat up here. All right. Well, I have a question. Is it okay to do something wrong if nobody sees you and you don't get caught? Definitely not. Well, in today's Bible story, somebody sinned, and he thought because no one saw, it was going to be okay. But it wasn't. So let's check it out.
Joshua had led the Israelites into the Promised Land. Now the Israelites had to defeat the people living there. God was with Israel, and he promised to fight for them. The Lord had helped the Israelites take over the city of Jericho. He had given them specific instructions about what to do with everything in the city. He told them what to destroy and what to set apart for the Lord. But the Israelites did not obey God completely. They kept some things for themselves, and God knew. So when the Israelites attacked the city of Ai, God did not fight for them. The men of Ai chased away the Israelites, and some of the Israelites were killed. Now the Israelites were afraid. Joshua was sad. He did not understand why Israel had lost the battle. But God said to Joshua, "Israel has sinned. They took some of the things I told them not to. This is why they lost the battle." The next day, the Israelites came together, and God showed Joshua which man had sinned. The man's name was Achan. Achan confessed that he had taken from Jericho a beautiful cloak, some pieces of silver, and a bar of gold. Achan had buried the things in his tent, so the people of Israel killed Achan and his family. After Achan was punished for his sin, God told Joshua to attack Ai again. This time, God promised to give them victory over the city. Joshua gathered an army. He sent some of the army out at night to lie in wait behind the city. Then early the next morning, the rest of the army went toward the city. The king of Ai saw them and sent out his men to fight them. When the army got near, Joshua and the Israelites ran away just as they had before. They pretended to be afraid, so the army of Ai chased them away from the city. The people of Ai had no idea that Joshua had men hiding on the other side of the city. The army of Ai left the city completely unprotected. Joshua held out his sword, and the men who were hiding took over the city and set it on fire. This time, the Israelites did just what God said. The army of Ai realized that they were trapped, and the Israelites defeated them. Joshua built an altar to the Lord. The Israelites sacrificed offerings to God, and Joshua read aloud the words of the law. All of the people heard the laws that Moses had commanded. The punishment for Achan's sin was death. It seems harsh, but the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. because we sin, we deserve to die too. Jesus came to die in our place. When we confess our sins and trust in Jesus, we are forgiven and saved from spiritual death.
The people of Israel were so excited after Jericho, and they expected to march to that next city, Ai, and they expected to win their battle. But is that what happened? No, this time God did not go with them. And the men of Ai chased the Israelites, and they won that battle. And so Joshua was confused. He knew that God had promised to give them victory. Something had gone wrong. Who can tell me what had gone wrong? Yes, Ruby. They sinned. That's right. Does anyone remember what the sin was? Very good. They took things from Jericho that God had told them not to do. And so Achan was his name, and he tried to hide his sin from everyone. But who knew about his sin? God knew about his sin, and he saw, and he punished him for that sin. And then, after he'd been punished, did God fight with the people of Israel again? He did, and they took over the city of Ai. So the punishment for Achan's sin was death. Does that seem a little harsh? It does, but we're told in the Bible that the wages of sin is death. And because we also sin, we deserve to die. But someone came and died in our place. Who died in our place? Yes, Ruby. Jesus did. And so when we confess our sins and we trust in Jesus, we get to be forgiven and we get to go forever into eternity with him and be saved. So when you guys come together as a family this week to talk about this lesson, we can talk about what are the penalties for sin and what should you guys be doing after you sin. And how can your sin affect other people? In our story, one man's sin affected all of Israel. That was a big effect. And then you can work on this week's memory verse. It's Joshua 1:9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Can we pray before we go back to our seats? All right. Father God, we confess that we don't always do what we're supposed to do, that sometimes we sin, and we know that that makes you sad. We thank you for sending your son, Jesus, to take the punishment that we deserve for our sin, and we praise you for this great grace upon us. We love you so much. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. All right, older kids, if you guys want to grab your clipboards. Everyone else, please stand at this time for this morning's passing of the peace, where you can greet your neighbors next to you.
All right. We're going to start the reading. So if you want to go back to your seats. Okay, and if you'll remain standing for the reading of God's word. We're going to be reading from Psalm 14 this morning, verses 1 through 7. The fool says in his heart, "There is no God. They are corrupt. Their deeds are vile. There is no one who does good. The Lord looks down from heaven on all mankind to see if there are any who understand, any who seek God. All have turned away. All have become corrupt. There is no one who does good, not even one. Do all these evildoers know nothing? They devour my people as though eating bread. They never call on the Lord. But there they are, overwhelmed with dread, for God is present in the company of the righteous. You evildoers frustrate the plans of the poor, but the Lord is their refuge. Oh, that salvation for Israel would come out of Zion. When the Lord restores his people, let Jacob rejoice and Israel be glad. The word of the Lord.
You'll have to pardon me this afternoon. This might be a tea-sipping sermon. Does that sound good? I guess I wasn't as big a believer on, elementary kids bringing home bugs from school, but I am definitely a believer now. Have our daughter in kindergarten. She's got the good immunity, and we're all just, like, suffering in the corner. So, anyway, it's good to be together, though. Thankfully, I'm on the upswing. It is not COVID, so I saw people starting to, like, sink down in the pews. You're okay. It's okay. Everything's fine. Well, we have been in the book of Psalms this summer in a series called Anatomy of the Soul. And special thanks to Robbie for opening up Psalm 13 last week. Thank you, Robbie. I was blessed by your opening up of that psalm and also your vulnerability too in sharing the ways that God met you in that. I feel it every week. God has a tendency to do like heart surgery on us as we prepare to open up the word. And also wanted to say, I should not gloss over this at all, but thank you. Thank you, thank you to everyone who helped in that big project of getting moved over, getting the offices moved over here to Emmanuel. Thank you so much. We appreciate you all. Whew. Every step of the way. Even down to things like, where's Betsy? I think Betsy's in here. She put all my books back on the shelves and everything. There's some semblance of order. I love it. But thank you so much. It's amazing to see the body of Christ at work. Well, would you pray with me before we dive in together? Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for your word, how you still speak to us today. We pray that you would meet us in our longings, in our fears, in our aspirations, in our hopes. Lord, speak to us. Plant your truth within us. Challenge us, motivate us, prepare us for what you have in store for us this day, this week, and beyond. And Father, would you help us to locate ourselves in this psalm? May it not just be something that applies to them over there, Lord, but would you reveal our own hearts? And Lord, would the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Repetition, repetition, repetition. It's one of the keys to learning, isn't it? Or perhaps maybe one of the ways to get something through this thick skull of mine. I don't know about you. I think about all the repeated flashcards that I used to prepare for those tests. I think about all of those free throws I practiced over and over and over again for basketball. I think about a lot of drills that we repeated over and over again to form muscle memory during my time in the Army. You know, the Bible is, it is a pretty big book. And it is rare for entire passages like this to be repeated nearly word for word. But Psalm 14 is one of them. Psalm 14 is repeated almost in its entirety in Psalm 53. And then quoted at length by Paul in Romans 3, where it is woven together in a string of other references to make his argument that there is no one righteous. It should cause us to sit up and take notice. And upon perhaps first reading or first hearing, maybe today, of this psalm, we can easily point the finger at others, atheists, fools, evildoers who are corrupt, those who are vile, those who devour God's people. But the more we read it, the more it reveals the corruption of our own hearts, of every human heart, and the tendency even of those who claim to follow Jesus to engage in practical atheism, to follow the allure of foolishness, and to bite and devour one another. So would you join me this evening in honestly assessing the conditions of our hearts and our own penchant for foolishness? Now, I don't expect all of us to have our chest cavities open and, you know, surgery be going on, but that might just break out. As the Word of God and the people of God and the Spirit of God interact. For God is present in the company of the righteous. And Psalm 14 falls squarely within the wisdom tradition of the Old Testament, but rather than striking perhaps a more reflective tone like Psalm 1, it drips with mourning, the mourning of the moral corruption of humankind and the longing for the day when the people of God will be fully restored. It advances in four movements. First, the credo of the fool in verse 1. And then the Lord's verdict in verses 2 through 4. Followed by God's defense, the defense of God's people in verses 5 to 6. And then finally, the longing for restoration in verse 7. So we'll begin with the credo of the fool. The credo, that word comes from the Latin word, which means I believe. It is basically a statement of beliefs that can also refer to one's guiding principles. You know, many of our neighbors here in Evanston have multicolored yard signs in front of their home, which is basically their credo, that is, a statement of beliefs. We have our own. We have one that we hold too dearly as a church called our statement of faith. But in the case of Psalm 14, it begins, "The fool says in his heart, there is no God." The word for fool here is not a reference necessarily to intellectual disability. It is a person without any sense of moral values who stubbornly rejects wisdom. And to understand who a fool is, you don't have to look much further than a character, probably lesser known character in the Bible called Nabal. 1 Samuel 25, somebody who David dealt with, whose name literally means fool. We just talked about dedicating cadence and parents choose these amazing names for their children. I don't hear a lot of people naming their kids Nabal these days. I don't know about you. Would not recommend as a baby name. But here he is, this fool who puts his life and the lives of those around him in danger. I would encourage you to read that passage almost as like a living parable of what a fool's life looks like. But the arrogance of the fool's assertion is found here in the statement of the fundamental belief that there is no God. But this is not necessarily a kind of philosophical atheism that denies the very existence of God. After all, that would have been very foreign in the days of David as he's writing this to the people and to the time when this takes place. Instead, this confident assertion on the part of the fool is that God is unconcerned with how they live and takes no interest in human affairs. We saw that same mantra, that same credo in Psalm 10 as well. Psalm 10, verse 4, "In his pride, the wicked man does not seek him. In all his thoughts, there is no room for God." These are those who deny God's rule in their life and refuse to admit that they are accountable for their actions. This is what we could call practical atheism. Practical atheism among those whose lives indicate that for all practical purposes, they live as atheists, disregarding God in their daily lives. The result is threefold. First, as to their inner character, they are corrupt, like milk that has turned sour. This pollution of their inner world is like that noted in the lead up to the flood in Genesis 6:12. God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. Second, this corrupt inner character spills over into their abominable outer conduct. Their deeds are vile, verse 1 says. And third, the clincher is that there is no one who does good. You know, there are a number of parallels between Psalm 14 and the book of Romans. I plan on pointing out a few of those along the way. But the first of which is the description of the fool in Romans 1, 21 to 22, that says, "For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools." Church, the sort of practical atheism that the psalmist calls out here is alive and well today. Granted, many may not declare there is no God, but still think that they will not be held to account, or that there are no long-range consequences to their actions. In the eyes of practical atheism, God is distant and has no bearing on one's life or relationships. And while it may be easy, again, to point the finger at those who explicitly reject God, I believe that this psalm is also a challenge to people who claim to be Christians, where it might seem as though God has very little visible impact on their lives. They may even attend church, while their character and conduct reveal that God is not at the center of their lives. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, writing from prison, wrote, "God is no stopgap. He must be recognized as the center of life. Not when we are at the end of our resources. It is his will to be recognized in life and not only when death comes. In health and vigor and not only in suffering. In our activities and not only in sin." This passage should cause us to ask God to look within our own hearts to see if there are hints of practical atheism in our own lives, in the way that we live, and how much time goes by before we even utter a prayer. It is revealing, is it not? Well, the view that God is not actively present in this world is actually, it's refuted by what happens next. In verses 2-4, we hear the verdict from the Lord. These are verses that are a theological assessment from the Lord's vantage point. God does, in fact, watch over the world and weigh human behavior. The Lord looks down from heaven. This is an underscoring of his sovereignty over his creation. It's a repeated refrain in Scripture. The Lord looked down in the days of Noah and saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become. The Lord looked down on the Tower of Babel and saw people seeking to make a name for themselves. The Lord looked down on Sodom and Gomorrah to see if there was even one righteous person in their midst. The Lord looked down on his rebellious people in the wilderness and saw as they bowed down to a golden calf. And here he looks down in order to assess the entirety of the human race, the children of man, as the ESV has it. All is laid bare before him. No one escapes his gaze. And he does so in order to see if there are any who understand, or another way of putting it, any who are wise, any who seek God. What becomes clear is that the fool is not some rare occurrence within the human race. No, all have deliberately, actively turned away. All have become corrupt. There is no one who does good, not even one. You can't help but notice the universal scope of the repeated terms, all and any, no one who does good. All human beings are, in fact, fools apart from the wisdom of God. And as we understand from the New Testament, there is no one who understands spiritual things apart from the Holy Spirit's special illuminating work in the human heart. Well, here again, Paul weaves Psalm 14, 1 through 3 into a string of quotes in Romans 3 to assert the universal human condition. No one is righteous. All human beings are corrupt, and no one can earn salvation through law keeping. Culminating, if you know this passage, in the words in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. No one can claim righteousness apart from what is given through faith in Jesus Christ. Well, examples of such corruption are then found in verse 4 of this psalm. Do all these evildoers know nothing? They devour my people as though eating bread. They never call on the Lord. Like a predator devouring its prey, they consume God's people with an insatiable appetite for more. And what's more, they never call on the Lord, for to call on him is to rely upon him for life, for goodness. This is an expression of feeling no need for God. At the end of the day, these verses speak especially to the universal human condition, and this is so important to us as a church that within our beliefs, even within our own statement of faith, there's a whole paragraph that is given to that called the human condition. To refamiliarize ourselves with it, it says this: we believe that God created Adam and Eve in his image, but they sinned when tempted by Satan. In union with Adam, human beings are sinners by nature and by choice, alienated from God and under his wrath. Only through God's saving work in Jesus Christ can we be rescued, reconciled, and renewed. Church, this does not just apply to some people. No, Psalm 14 demonstrates the universal scope of the human condition, what theologians refer to as total depravity. This is a term that doesn't mean that every person is as bad as they could be. Rather, it means that our moral depravity has come to pervade the entirety of our being, from our mind to our heart, our soul, our spirit, our body, our affections, our will, all of it. One question that arises, though, is how do we reconcile this with the seemingly good things that we see people that might be far from God do? I believe that these are expressions of what is known as common grace. John Murray defines this as common grace as every favor of whatever kind of degree falling short of salvation, which this undeserving and sin-cursed world enjoys at the hand of God. But at the end of the day, even our righteous acts, Isaiah 64 reminds us, are but filthy rags. This image, though, of devouring one another, or devouring God's people in verse 4, is one that particularly stands out to me. Eating bread is something that we do nearly every day. It's mindless. It is with an equally cavalier attitude that these people consume God's people, treating them as a means to an end. But this is an image that is also familiar to the prophet Micah. For in Micah 3, he uses it to call out Israel's rulers who cruelly exploit the people that they should be protecting. And in Galatians 5, verse 15, Paul uses it to reveal the tendency that we have among those who claim to follow Jesus to bite and devour one another. Instead, he urges us to walk by the Spirit. Church, do we consume others like bread while avoiding He who is the very bread of life? He alone who truly satisfies. Well, the fate of those that engage in such behavior is what is then taken up in the next few verses. For in the third movement, we find the defense of God's people. But there they are, overwhelmed with dread, for God is present in the company of the righteous. It is as if the verdict from the Lord in verses 2 through 4 inspires confidence on David's part. But the whole tone of the psalm shifts at this point. And it might be, it seems unclear as to what the "there" might refer to. It could be the situation in which David wrote in the first place. Perhaps a time when practical atheism came face to face with God, who is present in the company of the righteous, his active presence in this world. But what this does is it causes them to be overwhelmed with dread. Perhaps some of the most comforting words in this psalm are that God is present in the company of the righteous. The rebuttal to those who devour God's people and never call on the Lord is God's active presence among his people. Psalm 9, verse 9 says, "The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble." While the aim of evildoers is to keep the poor in oppression by frustrating their plans, the Lord is their refuge. They are not alone and can take refuge in the Lord who reigns over his people. Psalm 2:12 reminds us, "Blessed are all who take refuge in him." So two features as takeaways from these verses. The first is that, as we have seen and will continue to see again and again, God's heart is for the poor and the oppressed. His law forbids the exploiting of the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow. He takes special interest in them and punishes those who abuse them. And if we are honest with ourselves, are there ways that we perhaps unknowingly frustrate the plans of the poor through lifestyles that are built on exploitation? This quote from Gerald Wilson just like leapt off the page and like strangled me this week. It says this: "If we look carefully, we will have to admit that in many ways we are more closely related to the oppressive powerful than the exploited poor. This means that when we fail to acknowledge the suffering of the rest of our world, when we seek to preserve our own favored status at the expense of those who are less powerful than we, when we simply try not to think too hard about how our abundance is related to the poverty of others, then the judging words of Psalm 14 are directed to us, not just those faithless, foolish, evildoers out there." God's heart is for the poor and the oppressed. Second feature, a tension arises. I don't know if you felt this too, but a tension arises at this point in the text between the children of man, in verse 2, the corruption, universal corruption of the children of man, and then this amazing phrase, the company of the righteous. First hinted at in the phrase, "my people," right? In verse 4. How does one move from one to the next? Well, the Bible makes clear that though everyone is a sinner, God has made a way for some to be called his people. Not because of anything we do, but entirely because of God's mercy. And this is what we proclaim. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast." So speaking of becoming part of the company of the righteous, movement 4, the longing for restoration. David gives this final prayer for his people. It expresses confidence that the Lord will restore them. "Oh, that salvation for Israel would come out of Zion," he declares boldly in verse 7. Zion, as we have been picking up in bits and pieces here in the Psalms, is synonymous with Jerusalem, the capital of David's kingdom. Has a rich history in the Psalms. God is enthroned in Zion, in his sanctuary, the place where he is worshiped. God installed David as king on Zion, the holy mountain. God sends help from Zion, Psalm 20. Shines from Zion, Psalm 50. Rules from Zion, Psalm 110. And blesses from Zion, Psalm 128. Zion is where God's active presence with his people is most symbolized, most powerfully symbolized. And it is from Zion that David longs for salvation. picking up where he left off in Psalm 13, verse 5. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. When the Lord restores his people, let Jacob rejoice and Israel be glad. Not if the Lord restores his people, but when. When the Lord restores his people. Jacob and Israel, this is not some split personality here. No, these are the alternate names for Isaac's son. And far from non-existent or uninvolved, like the fool thinks, God is actively working to restore his people. And when he does, we will rejoice. This longing for restoration parallels Romans 8, 19 through 25, where it says that creation groans while awaiting liberation from bondage to decay. And just as God's people groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our full restoration. For at the end of the day, this psalm drips with the gospel, does it not? God created us in his image, but we deliberately turned away. And although we claimed to be wise, we became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made with human hands and traded the truth of God for a lie. Romans 1. As to our character, it is corrupt. As to our behavior, it is vile. There is no one who does good, not even one. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But that is not the end. God, in his mercy, did not leave us to our own devices. He did not say, have it your way and walk away. No. He intervened first by looking down from heaven to assess the condition of the children of man. First intervening by saying to Adam and Eve, where are you? Knowing full well where they were. Not only did he look down, but then he came down from heaven as a human child whose name was to be called Jesus, the Hebrew word for salvation, for he will save his people from their sins, Matthew 1. Christ lived in constant submission to the Father's authority. He lived a life without blemish or any trace of corruption. And Jesus, the bread of life, was devoured by death so that we could be restored. Salvation has come from Zion, and his name is Jesus. The Lord Jesus has shown us this better way and has become for us the wisdom from God. For as 1 Corinthians 1 reminds us, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Left to our own devices, we run to foolishness. We act foolishly. But in Jesus, there is wisdom from God that is able to save us and lead us in the way of righteousness and holiness. No one is righteous except Christ. Only through him can we become part of the company of the righteous. Sounds like a good band name. The company of the righteous. Even after joining such a company, we can be tempted, though, to act like everyone else, to become a fool, or to live as practical atheists. But church, God is present. God is present in the company of the righteous. We have experienced restoration in part and are called to live as wise people, acknowledging the Lord's authority, trusting him obediently while we await our blessed hope, the fullness of our restoration. For it is not a matter of if, but when. What a day of rejoicing that will be. Amen, church. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, we praise you that you are indeed present in the company of the righteous, that you are actively involved in every detail of our lives, and that you did not leave us to our own devices, but you made a way for us to be radically reconciled to you. Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you. Even as we come to the table and as we remember, we celebrate all that you endured on the cross and how you were devoured so that we could live. We pray that you would cause us to draw near to you. May we not live as practical atheists in this world. But Lord, we thank you that that day of restoration is coming. That day of rejoicing is at hand. We love you, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Our brother Robbie is going to come and lead us in this time of communion and of celebration together.
EBF. My name is Robbie Givergeese, and we're going to move into a time of communion together as we continue to consider and reflect on the really sobering words of David in Psalm 14. Romans 3, 22 to 26 reminds us that the Lord does indeed restore his people through his Son. It reads, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith." So as we take this communion today, we remember and we commemorate this act of atonement for our sins. The breaking and eating of the bread points to Christ's body being physically broken on the cross for us. And the drinking from the cup points to Christ's blood being shed on the cross on behalf of our sins. And so as we eat these elements of communion this evening, we affirm by faith that we have fellowship together in the work, in the resurrection of Christ Jesus. So before we partake in the Lord's table together, we're going to take a couple minutes to spend some time in quiet reflection and confession. As a reminder, the Lord's table is meant for those who have made a profession of faith and have believed in the death and resurrection of Jesus and the forgiveness of our sins through him and him alone. And if you haven't yet made this profession, we ask that you would refrain from taking the elements, but would you consider deeply the words of David and as well as from Romans and consider the implications of what Christ's death on the cross might have on your life? So when you're ready, we have the communion elements here to my right as well to my left. So feel free to come up and take the elements. You can either take them here or you can take them back to your seat. Just come up whenever you're ready and had an opportunity to reflect on what the cross might mean for you. We'll also have our elders and Tim and their wives as well available in the back. Just believing the words of James 5:14 when it says, "Is anyone among you sick? Let them call of the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with the oil in the name of the Lord." And so it would be their joy to be able to pray with you and to talk with you about anything that might be going on in your life. So would you hear the words of the institution of the Lord's Supper in 1 Corinthians 11:23 to 25 as it reads, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, broke it, and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Would you pray with me? Father, we're so grateful for your Son, Jesus. Through the empty tomb, you have overcome sin and death and have given us new life. And Father, as we reflect on your great grace and mercy, may our lives be offered as a living sacrifice, pleasing and acceptable in your sight. We pray this in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. Me. Today's benediction comes from 1 Corinthians 1:30. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. EBF, you guys are dismissed.